Good evening, and welcome to the second night of Puppet Arts Finals for the University of Connecticut. My name is Bart Rockelburton. I am director of the Puppet Arts Program, and we're a very unique program in terms of training for puppeteers, not only in the US, but around the world, offering BFA, MA, and MFA degrees in the art of puppetry. Our program is now 55 years old, and we have trained puppeteers from every corner of the world. So we're quite proud of them. I do want to start this evening by celebrating three of our, I'm going to say they're current students still. We have had three MFA students. Am I not on? Here we go. We have had three MFA students finish up their all the requirements for their degrees. And so I would like to celebrate Abby Bosley from Philadelphia, Maggie Flanagan from New Hampshire, and Netta Itzadi from Tehran, Iran. Sorry, my Zoom just disappeared. I hope I'm still on. There we go. Okay. I would very much like to thank the Ballard Institute Museum of Puppetry, John Bell being the director, for hosting this this event these past 2 days and all the events that you folks are doing. Please pay attention to their calendar. There are many events being offered across the internet. You want to go to bimp.uconn.edu for that information. And I would especially like to thank Emily Wicks and Paul Spirito and Tracy Becker for sort of serving as our air traffic controllers tonight. They have organized this event last night's and this night's in a beautiful way. It was really terrific. Faculty in the Puppet Arts Program include Dr. John Bell, Dr. Matthew Cohen, myself, Ulysses Jones, and Paul Spirito. And the work you're going to see this evening is from Matthew Cohen's hand puppet class. We're very honored to be joined tonight by Blair Thomas, who is the founder of Blair Thomas & Company, a performance company in Chicago, but he's also the founder and artistic director of the Chicago International Puppet Festival. Blair will be making some commentaries following the events, following the presentations tonight, and we hope that you stick in and enjoy what he's saying. We do invite you to make comments in the chat box. This will be watched and fed to us as we move through the evening. So without further ado, I would like to introduce you to Dr. Matthew Cohen, who will explain what you're going to be seeing this evening.
Thank you, Bart. I'm muted. Thank you, Bart. Welcome everyone to the finals of hand puppetry. And I'm very pleased indeed, as Bart mentioned, to be working today with the Ballard Institute and Museum of Puppetry in the broadcasting of these finals. And I'd like to thank as well, Emily Wicks and Paul Spirito and Tracy Becker, as well as my colleague, John Bell, for their contributions to tonight's event. This semester, hand puppetry students have made a deep dive into this form of puppetry with a focus on hand ballet, that is hands as puppets, a little bird, ball-headed, unclothed hand puppets, such as you see here, which is a form which was developed by the great Russian puppeteer Sergei Obratsov, who came up for mention in last night's finals. Punch and Judy, and we had the honor of being tutored directly by one of the UK's foremost punch professors, Glenn Edwards. Budaichi, our Chinese hand puppets. And we also had the honor of being tutored by a great expert in this form, Yung Fai, who taught us via Skype from Paris, with briefer glimpses at wrist puppets, with finger puppets, and of course, you can't forget sock puppets as well. There you go. And a variety of modern contemporary iterations of glove puppetry as well. As a final assignment for this course, students were charged with creating an original hand puppet play, recounting a Connecticut legend, story, piece of history, or personage. And in this way, these pieces recognize the University of Connecticut's mission as the state's flagship public university to enhance the social, economic, cultural, and natural environments of the state. Students were asked to mine hand puppetry's potential as a medium, demonstrating, among other things, performance skills we've been working on this semester, such as focus, puppet posture, clear movements, meaningful gestures, supporting dialogue, contrast among puppet voices, convincing characterization, effective dialogue, control of rhythm and pace, and careful positioning or blocking of puppets in the service of narrative. Remarkably, these plays that we're about to see were all developed while students were sheltering in place, using available materials and means, but also were supported through twice weekly workshops where we worked together as a class and also in small groups to develop plot structures, characters, visual design, staging, and performance interpretation. All of the plays you're about to see have been pre-recorded. Some are live puppet performances that have been shot live for the camera, while others are puppet videos, which were created specifically for the camera. A couple have some adult content. So if there are any families with smaller children present, I'll try to give some trigger warnings beforehand. We are joined, as Bart mentioned, by Blair Thomas from Chicago, who has been asked to respond briefly to each performance, followed by a very brief response from the puppeteer creator. And possibly, if time allows, we'd like to also have these students answer questions, which can be submitted to puppeteers as Facebook Live comments. And we'd like to encourage people to use the comment function in Facebook Live to post comments, reflections, questions, and greetings to the students and to make this a lively event. So for the first video we'll be looking at tonight, we'll be seeing a performance piece by Genna, Beth, Davidson entitled The Magic Garden. I'll see you after this is plays on the screen now.
Oh! Hello there, internet friends. My name is Adelma. Welcome to my garden, Caprilands. My family and I just bought this place. It's 1929. We are going to have a goat farm. Yes, that's why we called this place Caprilands. Capri is Latin for goat. I just love history. This plant has a great history too. My mom just gave it to me, and she got it from her mother before her. Isn't that great? My mom says I'm to be the keeper of the plant now. I'm not really sure what that means, but I know that plants love the sun, and so I brought my plant out here to get some sun while I wait for the arrival of our new goat. Oh, here she comes now. Hello, goat. Bah. Hello. Welcome to Caprilands. Bah. Let's call you Sabrina. Do you like that? Bah. Oh, good. Well, Sabrina, I have to go run some errands, but when I get back, we will get some goat's milk from you. Yes, because we are going to be selling goat's milk. Yes, 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 yes. Bah. Oh no, oh no, oh no! new flower. It won't be the same, but let's see. Rosemary. Well, that sounds nice, don't you think? Okay. Shovel. Okay, and then I think put a seed in the hole. And okay. Okay, well, I think that does it. So, my back. Oh, I'm really tired after all that. I'm just gonna take a nap. Will you wake me up when something starts to happen with the seed? Okay, great.
Of beautiful
herb gardens. Yes, it was years of hard work, but I loved every minute of it. And soon I was writing books about herbs. People really found them just as magical as I did. Rosemary helped. She taught me all about their magical properties. And I had luncheons at Caprilands and gave tours. And I became known as the Herb Lady and the White Witch because I loved the herbs so much and used them for all of their wonderful purposes. Ah, yes. It was a beautiful place. Years and years went by. More and more people came and went. I created memories for people and the books and my gardens, and I'm vamping here. Rosemary!
Yes?
Please take it from here.
Oh, right. Well, years and years went by, as Adelma said, and then she started talking about leaving. I didn't know what she meant. She had created beautiful gardens, written all the books, and everything was going well. Where was she going? What was she talking about?
Rosemary, you and I have had many beautiful seasons here together. I can't believe it's been almost 60 years. The gardens are thriving and well-loved, but our lives are so different. You can go on living for hundreds of years. I cannot.
Oh, Adelma, I don't want you to go. Who will take care of us?
I don't know, Rosemary. Others love the garden, just not as much as me. But we'll think of something. In the meanwhile, I thought we could brew ourselves a magic potion of protection. We'll use artemisia. That is the plant that represents bitterness and absence, which you will soon experience when I am gone. And sage, that is a plant of long life. Oh, and Rosemary, I have had a very long life. I am 93, and this is rue. It is the herb of grace. And time, oh, for bravery. Now, Rosemary, I am going to take all these back to the house and brew us a potion, and we will sprinkle it over the land in the morning. Good night, Rosemary.
Oh, well, Adelma did not wake up in the morning. We never cast the magic spell. It's been 20 years now since Adelma walked in her magical Caprilands. I'm beginning to get crowded by other plants. I'm not sure how much longer I can survive without a friend to care for me. Oh, I'm here, but I'm not doing very well.
Well, Street, Coventry, Connecticut. Hello? Is this Caprilands, Miss Adelma?
She died a long time ago.
What? Who said that? What? Oh! A talking plant. Oh, well, that's new. I was hoping to meet Adelma, but I've been reading her books. You look like a Rosemary?
Yes, my name is Rosemary. I'm not very well.
Oh, well, is it because of all these weeds? Here, let me help.
Oh, I feel so much better already.
Oh, well, my name is Juniper, and I've been reading Adelma's books. I was hoping to find herb. I want to be like Adelma. I want to be a white witch, too. That's what they called her.
Oh, yes, and the herb lady they called her, too. There's not much to show these days. Caprilands is in ruins. No one was here to fill her giant shoes when she died.
She had big feet. Interesting.
Actually, she was rather small. What I meant was she did everything for this place.
Oh, well, at least she left behind all the books with instructions on how to care for you and the other plants. Rosemary, what do you think about me taking over and caring for the plants?
Well, what do you know about business?
Nothing, but I am really hardworking, and I have a dream that this place could be as magical as it once was.
Oh,
that's got to be worth something.
Oh, more than you know, Juniper. Here, take one of my branches and brew yourself a cup of tea.
Okay.
And we'll get to work in the morning.
Oh, great! This is going to be a beautiful friendship, Rosemary. Wait and see.
Maybe there is some magic left after all.
Thank you very much, Jenna Beth. We'll now have a few words from Blair Thomas.
Hello, Jenna. Thank you for that piece. It has a wonderful energy to it, and the spirit of making a little biopic of this. Adelma, historical character, is well served with this the solo hand puppet show. Particularly what was nice was the personification of the herbs as characters, a great device, and good for just like unusual puppetry, but also in terms of narrative, like that you have a character that doesn't die, right? That's in a biopic story. It offers you this foil in a sense to literally carry on the narrative of the story. Like this is a person who has a legacy, and it becomes personified by them. By the puppet of Rosemary, and which is great, and then you can have this generational thing play out, which is really fun. I think the rascalness of the goat is a great opening, I would encourage the goat be even more of a little monster, right? Just like take the spirit of Punch and let the show start off with a wild mess of a beginning, like it's, which is great because it's sort of like this is like that you have this sort of plot thing that this is not what I need to do with my life, you know. Instead, I need to come up with something else. I think is a really great opening to the piece, and then you've got this sort of trick where you're putting in a lot of story in dialogue, right, which is a challenge, and I think for the most part it comes off pretty well. I think there's certain ways it can get tightened up for sure. I think the two hand puppets that are human characters are really well rendered, and particularly the predecessor woman who comes at the end, she has a very strong sculptural form. It really is very pleasing in the different angles that, like, I love looking at her profile, and then it's just like she's a pleasure to look at, really nice, and the scale of the head being is a lot. There's something, you got the proportion right on that, really strong. And the main character is also, I think, well sculpted. Like, I was noticing this last night in your design, on pretty good with your own aesthetic form that I just encourage you to indulge in. All these things are strengths of the work. Allowing the hand puppet to, hand puppets are really, since they're directly connected to the palm of the puppeteer, they have a special kind of life to them. So I think you should at times look for ways in which that can that energy can come out into the piece a little bit more. That obviously in the notion of the goat at the beginning, but even the other element of that needs to be tamed in the end are the weeds that come into play, and then the character who has to then defeat the weeds. There's always a hand puppets love to defeat something, right? And so in your narrative, you have these things that need to be tamed, beaten back, you know, and then the nuances of them discovered, right? So I just try to play into the form with your narrative. This is my general thoughts.
Yeah.
Thank you so much, Blair. Do we have a minute or two for a response from Genna Beth?
Oh, I mean, that all makes sense to me. I mean, it's a very new form to me. I've never done hand puppetry, although I've been doing puppetry a long time. This form is very new to me. I think that makes sense to lean into the form. So it's surprising to me, the hand puppet I used for Juniper, the last character, it wasn't initially designed for this piece. And I was surprised. I think that head comes across really well on the camera. Which was surprising. I made it last semester for a different class, but ended up using it for this out of necessity. I was really pleased the way it looked. So. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. There's the icon of the hand puppet, you know, it also has the thing to mostly we're watching it from distance rather in live performance. So it's a distillment that's remarkably limited, but marvelously expressive. It's a contradiction to it. And so perhaps that head looks good from a distance as well. That's what I would guess. I don't
know. Yeah, I've ways to go, but it was fun to figure it out, you know, play around with it. So yeah, thanks for being there.
Yeah. Thank you both. We're going to turn now to the next performance of the evening, which is actually a video for puppet video by Willow Giannotti. And the title of this is Fungos.
Hi, I'm Possum. Welcome to Fungos. Today on Fungos, we're gonna be having a look at these here Connecticut logs. We got our trusty magnifying glass and we're gonna see what we can find. Come on. Hey, there's nothing I love more than a nice rotting log. Am I right, kids? Oh, hey, look over here. We got one. Some of these guys can get pretty tiny, so we're gonna need our trusty magnifying glass to help us out. Come have a look. Like Mr. Slug wanted a snack. Here, let's check out over here. Mr.
Mr. Slug and Mr. Snail are what we call detritivores. They're eating the decaying material of this log. They help to break it down and transform it back into soil for more trees to grow. Looks like we found some mushrooms. They eat the nutrients that live inside this log, the decaying materials, the water and such. It keeps them alive. Let's see. Like seeds for mushrooms. Mr. Worm is a detritivore too. They also break down these materials and then poop it out. Cycle of life, huh, guys? Sorry. Out here in the forest, anything can happen, huh? I didn't think that would. Hey, buddy.
Thank you, Willow. I'd like to invite comments again from Blair Thomas, and then to hand it over to Willow to respond or to anything that come up on the Facebook Live comments or chat.
Great, Willow, that's a great piece, really super fun. A lot of great energy and surprising. You're a wonderful kind of master of ceremonies of the fungal world. You've done an excellent job of working with scale. You're doing a lot of stuff with camera work that's beyond the work of puppetry that's really benefiting your piece. And so it's a really great prototype for this work. Like, just in terms of, we have the shot of, we understand where what world we're in, and then we go into the finger puppets, and all of a sudden we're in a small world. The world is small, but it's not so small. It's not microscopic. You come up with simple devices like the magnifying glass to say we're stepping into a smaller kingdom, and then you've got all these smaller hand and finger puppets, which are all are super colorful. I love the design of them. They're all really interesting to look at. And can you hear me?
Sorry, your audio just cut out.
Oh, sorry. Okay.
After you said simple devices, your audio cut out. Sorry about that.
The simple devices like the magnifying glass that allows us to enter into a different scale. So just to say that sense of you figured out. I mean, you're using film composition to create scale, but it's really important for your narrative. You're sort of like this science class in hand puppetry. But all your little characters, the slug and the snail and the all these little guys who are they're very charming and fun. Another really strong part of the piece is the music. Did you as well do the music?
No. I had help from the initial song is Nirvana. And then the song for the bulk of it is just a jazz piece that I really love. And then actually my little brother helped me find music from the video game Minecraft for the worm section that I really just loved a lot.
Well, anyway, there's an editing of the music that really works well with the piece. So I'm not familiar with any of those tunes, but it helps move the piece in a very strong way. But little jokes like the slurping, that they're slurping the water out of the log. And then the piece also has this great edge to it. The cycle of life that ends up kind of stopping the story is because it is very warm and friendly, and then the horror section where the bird comes in is all the composition is very tight and really effective. You have a cast of characters that you pulled together. There's a lot of them. There wasn't like, I've seen this puppet before. I'm seeing it too much at all. So in terms of your balance of the length of your piece and its storytelling objectives, the puppetry was a very strong support for it. So congratulations on that.
Thank you so much.
Do you respond to Blair or to any of the comments which have come in?
Yeah, so I saw two people were asking what they're made of. So I actually, one of the big inspirations for the piece was just the materials that I have, because I'm not a puppetry major, so I don't have a lot of materials lying around. But when I had to do this piece, I just sort of went around my room and found stuff that I had that I could use. So they're made out of old t-shirts, paper mache, and then a few months ago, I found this piece of pink insulating foam in the trash. And so it's carved and sanded down. And then they're like painted and like stuffed and stuff. But yeah, it was really fun.
Wow. Very impressive in resourcefulness. That's excellent.
Thank you so much.
Yeah, yeah.
Great. Well, thank you very much, both of you. Our next piece is another biographical piece. It's titled Muckraker's Delight and is created and performed by Felicia Cooper.
Well, it's good to see you here in my office. And sorry, it's a bit of a mess. Yes, and there's room for you right here. I do apologize. It's just that I'm in the throes of a fascinating research project and... Oh, gosh. Well, it's taking a while. You see, I am investigating the practices of Standard Oil. It's a bold project. I mean, even my father said, "Don't do it, Ida. You'll ruin the magazine." At the time, of course, I was working for McClure's magazine in New York City, not my comfortable Connecticut office you join me in here today. goodness, and I suppose he was right. I mean, from the very beginning, there was a persistent fog of doubt and suspicion surrounding my practice of research. I mean, Standard Oil has been under investigation from several lawmaking bodies and law-abiding bodies, might I add, for their exploitation of workers and for their restriction of free trade, any number of things. But any time I went to go and understand the documents surrounding these investigations, someone would say, "Oh, you'll never find them. They've all been destroyed." Oh, goodness me. What was that? A chill runs through my bones. A stench of wealth pervades my nostrils. Could it have been none other than John Rockefeller?
No, I'm not John Rockefeller. I'm Ron Junkefeller. No many here. Big sports guy, see?
Oh, really? A big sports guy, huh?
Yeah, my tournament. Just on my way to my tournament.
Well, I certainly hope you get there. I mean, I hear that the railroads are going under.
What? Who told you that? Oh my gosh, please, 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 please tell me who told you. That's not public information yet.
Oh, get up. Get a grip of yourself, boy. I mean, here, why don't you sit on this little pedestal? That will make you more comfortable. Okay, that's better. And I tell you what, I'll give you three guesses in order to tell me what I already know.
Who told you? Who told you? Was it, God?
What? No. Why would it be God?
Well, God has given me ruling power over the working class and, the right to hoard more wealth than anyone of this era.
No. God, I shudder to think. Hey, take another guess. You love second chances.
Was it... Oh, Henry H. Rogers? That guy'll tell anybody anything as long as he can bet on it. What a snitch. What a gambler.
Henry H. Rogers, you say? Do you have any contact information for him? Perhaps his LinkedIn address?
What? No! Oh, my watch. My gold watch is getting so heavy. Oh, I have to go home now. Bye.
What? You come back here. Oh, he's always shirking his responsibilities, isn't he? Well, what he doesn't know is, of course, I already interviewed Henry Rogers. I'm no fool. I mean, let me tell you about it. It was a while ago, but I have a pretty good memory of how it went down. Thank you so much for meeting me here today.
Oh, it's my honor. What did you say your name was again, dear girl?
Ida Tarbell.
Oh, yes, Tarbell's tank shops. Goodness, yes. I could put my finger on the map where your father's shop stood. Yes, good days. Oh, dear.
Oh, I'm so happy you remember. Oh, goodness. Excuse me. I do tend to get a bit out of my element here.
Oh, no problem, young thing. It's so nice to see a smart whippersnapper like yourself taking an interest in Standard Oil. Now tell me, how did your interest in Standard Oil begin?
Oh, well, it was here, in my hometown, on the flats, hills, and, well, my favorite finicky mountains of Roseville.
Oh, yes! Oh,
and I do remember your home. A beautiful, white-peaked Victorian roof. Oh, how lovely. And to think, we didn't even own it.
You didn't? What do you mean?
Well, we rented it from Rockefeller. You see, and every cent that we saved, I put directly into stocks.
What a gamble. How could you justify the cost? How could you trust Rockefeller?
Well, I have always been a bit of a gambler, you see. When the markets are closed, the stock markets are closed, what I do is I have a little gamble, a little poker game in my own home. Speaking of which, have you seen my watch? Have you seen a... Well, just keep an eye out. I can never keep track.
Of your watch?
No, dear, of time, of my winnings. Win, lose, time just keeps moving.
I see. Lovely, lovely. I can see that you're a gambling man. I remember one day the schools were closed because all my teachers were out in that stock market of yours. I asked my father if maybe I could take a chance, maybe I could try my hand. I never received so stern a lecture.
No daughter of mine! Oh, et cetera, et cetera! I never did see your father at any of my poker games. No, sir. Goodness. Now, tell me, you're writing a book, and on what are you basing your research?
Purely on documents. I know this might put you in a bit of an odd position, Mr. Rogers, because you work for Mr. Rockefeller, but I need those documents. Even you as a first-person resource would be helpful. I don't expect you to change the policy, but...
standards have changed what? Changed somewhat at Standard Oil. You see, we are releasing documents to certain citizens here and there.
I see. Oh, my goodness. I mean... Do tell.
Well, you see, very interesting, actually. Well, you know about the railroads, but do you know about the pipelines?
No! I mean, do tell.
Well, that's where Rockefeller really got himself into trouble, really boxed himself into a corner, you see. When you own every aspect of production, it becomes difficult to have anyone else to blame because, well, all blame has to fall on you. The customers didn't know that, of course, but what can you do? They're so small anyway.
I see. Mr. Rogers, I guess that leads me to a question.
Oh, what's that, dear?
Well, goodness, you own stock in Mr. Rockefeller's company.
Yes, of course.
And you are kind of powerful.
Not powerful enough to move those mountains like you do, girl.
But, well, why didn't you stop it? Why didn't you say anything? Why didn't you stop the exploitation of workers, the restriction of free trade?
You see, this is Standard Oil's obsession. We cannot let any company, no matter how small, overtake us. Anyone could become large who was once small, just like we did. And we can't run the risk. That's a gamble I'm not willing to take.
I understand.
I'll tell you what, girl, why don't you come to my office sometime? I'll tell you some things.
You would be willing to meet again?
On conditions. You tell me what you know, and I'll tell you what I know.
Oh, Mr. Rogers, I must be clear here. My book, my story, my research cannot be dictated by the rights of Standard Oil. It must be my own process. My opinion must be something I can stand by at the end of this process. I might be made wrong eventually, but this is the time to tell the truth.
You young people. Well, keep an eye out for my watch, huh? I'll see you in my office sometime. Just let my secretary know.
Oh my goodness. And while I'm out here moving mountains, climb this mountain I did. It was no problem. I just kept asking the questions. I kept not being afraid. I kept swallowing my fear in order to interview all the people that I could, in order to gain all the information that I could. I just kept climbing. Oh, this is a special day indeed. My book, ha, to be published. Can you believe it? I just hope it helps someone. Portrait stands in the walls of the Supreme Court. It did help. In fact, it was used in the Supreme Court case to show evidence against Standard Oil for their mistreatment of workers and for their restriction of free trade, for their horizontally integrated monopoly. And now, on the walls of the Supreme Court, I see hundreds of young reporters willing to move mountains. Does my heart good.
Thank you, Felicia. Blair, over to you for a few words.
Great. Felicia, what a delight. Very beautiful little piece. Oh my goodness. The dialogue has such a great legs to it, just moves and keeps us totally engaged. And your economy as a puppeteer is really fabulous. It's like you have your eye on the work in a way that there's not obstacles in your obstructing you, and this is a little bit like the tool of puppetry is fully sharpened and at use for your storytelling skills, and it's really a pleasure to have you entertain with so much information at the same time. On this video, we fall into the world that you create with your language and your imagery. And then you change the set and it's just like, oh my God, it's practically sitting on her lap, this puppet show. It's like, there's nothing to it. It's like a dress is thrown over the back of a chair and it's a file folder drawn to be a set piece. It just, we spring back to just how nothing it is because it contrasts where you take us with your manipulation as well as with your use of language. So your playwriting skills and are really wonderful. Your performance is very strong. So there's tons of little things you're doing. The character voices are exquisite. The main character was the best. You really embodied her voice well and just wrapping your tongue around really great words in speaking that just very evocative. And then the puppets are so simple that they're stupid, but there's no problem with that. There's such a delight, particularly the figures with the hands in the second half of the piece are it is great in that you break the convention and you use the hand as your hand pointing and gesturing, and then quick you're back. This is the thing, the hand is the most responsive part of the human body, and this is why the hand puppet is so dynamic, and the smallest little things happen so quickly with what you're doing, and it keeps us on the edge of our seats with that, and that's what makes it a delight. I mean, otherwise it could be an unbelievably dry, dull story you're telling about this journalist who wrote a book about a guy who was a capitalist. It's like, but it wasn't that. It was an entertainment and it was fun. It was like, I would watch it again. Anyway, some small things about your wonderful work. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Yeah. Thank you for saying all that. I really appreciate it.
Yeah. Well, you had such a good time. Did you have a good time? You look like you're having a good time.
Yeah, definitely. It took quite a journey, you know. I think there were a lot of different iterations of this piece. I had to kind of start it over a bunch of times, and the shape kept changing. I think I'm happy with where it is now. So thank you.
You should be. The structure of it is very sound. I think that, you know, that I feel like the text comes out of writing as well as improv. It feels like you have the combination of those two things, because you have so much information that you're putting in there. At the same time, there's a elasticity to your performance that's really responsive. So that's successful.
Thank you.
Not easy to do.
Tarbell's books were really helpful in that she wrote a ton in her own voice, and I was able to just kind of like lift those sentences out. And so she made it easy for me.
Mm-hmm. Excellent.
Thank you all. We're going to go on to the next video of the evening. This is Foggy Memory by Mateo Villanueva.
I just don't know. And that's my entire issue. I just don't know. How long have I been just floating around in what appears to be not heaven, not hell? It must be purgatory. Oh, maybe this will help jog my memory. Yes. Oh, let's see. Oh.
Your name?
I wish I knew. I've been trying to figure that out for, it seems like, forever.
What an incredible coincidence! I too am suffering from the same issue. Would you please help me?
Honestly, I'd much rather solve my own issue. On my own. By myself.
Oh, well, if that's how you feel, I'll just leave you alone then.
Thank you. Good luck. Can I help you?
I thought you didn't want to help me. You want to solve your own problems there, buddy.
Don't you buddy me. I don't even know who you are.
Oh. Well, that's true.
Wait.
Yes?
What is that you just grabbed?
Oh, it looks like a hat.
Oh, well, looks a little bit big for you to wear. Could I, try that on?
Sure.
Yes. Yes, I wore a hat like this all the time. Yes, I remember. Oh. It was always a nice fit. It's a little bit damaged, but still wearable. Perhaps I was a bit harsh in our introduction. I suppose I could help you. That is, if you would, wouldn't mind helping me.
Oh, yes, of course. I am quite fond of helping people. At least I think I am, or, well, maybe you don't know, but, you know, I, can't seem to remember.
All righty then. Well, let's continue searching, shall we? Maybe on the second floor.
Huh. A ship sailed from New Haven, and the keen and frosty airs that sailed her sails at parting were heavy with good men's prayers. Are you remembering what I'm remembering as well?
Unfortunately so. I can picture it all now. That thick fog. Oh, those rushing waters. I'm remembering it all very well now, John.
Oh, yes, well, I was thinking the same. Wait. John. Are you sure that was my name?
After reading that, I am positive. And the ships that came from England, when the winter months were gone, brought no tidings of this vessel, nor of Master Lamberton. I figured it out. I figured it out. I know who I was. George Lamberton, captain of that ship that sailed across the seas from New Haven, yes. 1446, yes. Oh, you, John, yes, you were there with me. You helped me get all those goods on that ship that we had a lot of help with. Oh.
Yes, yes, you're right, yes. Oh, I knew that hat served some sort of purpose. Oh, yes.
We've got to let the people know. We're still here. Oh.
How do you suppose we do that sort of thing?
I've I've got a few ideas. Here, hold on.
All right.
What is that?
Thank you, Matteo. Claire, any yes. words from you?
All right. Matteo, thank you for that work. Thank you. The main characters, which are these enigmatic figures of some former domestic garment that are lost in a home, trying to discover their identity, has a great quality to that. Like there's the simple use of those puppets and their utter confusion about who they actually are, because they themselves are almost indistinguishable, and it's there's this great place as we enter into the work that like they're trying to figure out who they are in the same way that we're trying to figure out who they are, and there's a tension that you've created with this kind of existential dilemma in a very otherwise domestic, very common situation. So that this is where you're using the limitations of what you got. You're shooting in your house. You've got a very limited use of puppets and you come up with this inventive notion. So I like this idea that they're kind of wandering around trying to discover their identities. This is the strong point of the piece, and then they've kind of slowly it kind of dawns on them through the discovery of this ancient document by the sink, which is just right by the soap dish is this document from 17th century. the spirit of playfulness that's going on with that is nice. And also there's this funny thing that's going on with it's kind of eerie that and I'm not sure what it was, the way it's shot in terms of lighting. That the puppets are this kind of flat kind of quality, but they're moving around in this. Anyway, these kinds of things that you're using in relationship to it's a huge challenge to make an existential dilemma for these puppets and then actualize that in the piece. You know, that's what you kind of set out for yourself. And then at the end, you know, the ghost appearance of the ship at the end comes kind of suddenly and quickly, and if I didn't understand fully the context of it, I'm not sure if I would have gotten that. There was but I like that the notion of it, that it's the where, like, I almost feel like could the ghost ship have traveled more within the context of the piece for us to just take it in, like how is it coming and haunting people? You know, is it actually seen? Or is it something that's just they think they're seeing everywhere in their house? Like that last guy who comes in, who's sort of like this, oh, he's like this pedestrian guy. I think there could have been a whole kind of cat and mouse thing between the very simple cutout of the ghost ship and him seeing it in a variety of different places. It would have played in with the spirit that you're already doing, right? And so this kind of thing, like whenever this kind of lotsy of hand puppetry can be at play, this is kind of the spirit of the form. And so you were doing that in this in many ways with the piece. I just would encourage you more with that. What was your experience of working with that on that piece?
It was a lot of fun. I was hoping for, and I learned a lot from just from taking this class alone. I had not really done much with the general hand puppetry before, and it was just a really great experience to be able to learn from Matthew, and he also mentioned Glenn Edwards, and it was just a really, really great experience to figure out just like the really like subtle movements in my hands could create such a broad range of emotions of like just with these two simple characters.
Yeah, excellent. It's true, for sure. Yeah. Well, good. Well, congratulations on that.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Yeah. Thank you, Blair, and congratulations, Matteo. We're now roughly at the halfway point of this evening. We've seen four pieces. For the fifth out of nine, for the fifth piece, we'll be looking at The Wacky Glaucus by Alyssa Matthews. I just to give a warning, there's a small trigger warning that there's some disturbing scenes of blood and gore, blood and gore in this video made for the camera.
Once upon a time, in the magical land of Glastonbury, Connecticut, in 1939, on a gorgeous sunny day, something mysterious happened. Strange hurricane brought in an unknown creature.
Whoa, 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 where am I? This isn't the land I live in. Oh, wow. Whoa. Well, wherever I am, it sure is beautiful here.
This creature was named Glaucus, and he began to explore this new world, finding new things at every corner.
Look at this tree! Hi, tree! Look at these pretty flowers! Hi, flowers! Look at this warm sun! Look at this grass! Hi, grass! Wow! There are so many special things to see! Now, if only I had someone to share this with! Meep, meep! Oh my goodness! A bunny! Hi, bunny!
Glaucus continued on his journey in search of an animal friend.
Mow, mow!
Oh my goodness! Look at this cow! Hi, cow!
Mwah.
Oh, wow. Something tastes pretty yummy in my mouth. Mm.
Okay. Glaucus continues on in the forest.
Bah, bah. Oh, 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 look at the sheep. Hi, sheep. Will you be my friend? Oh, such a cute sheep. He's so soft and fluffy. Oh, and you smell really good, too.
I'm getting paid 21 cents less than any man's dollar in this economy. I have 3 other jobs and I still can't afford rent. Then what about my contract? Did I ever even f***ing get a contract? No, because student film doesn't f***ing work that way. Ah, God, this is the last time I ever answer an ad on Craigslist. Oh, and another thing, that food they gave us? I'm a vegetarian. Oh, shit.
Thank you, Alyssa, for that entertaining puppet video, the wacky Galakis. Blair, any words on this one?
Yes, Alyssa, thank you. You're on top of hand puppet energy with that piece. And it takes a little while for it to kind of sink in. There's obviously this thing that happens, but it escalates in a very welcomed way. And you've got this sort of Dr. and Jekyll with amnesia, you know, who's just can't figure out, you know, so how he can make a friend, and that you take a evil character and you treat it with sympathy is a wonderful device. So you're just like, oh, he's just looking, he just wants to have a friend just like anybody else wants a friend, and consider that there's this other side, and he doesn't quite understand that he's a horrible, that he devours and other be, you know, so this, it's a, this contradiction is a wonderful, is a great tension, because the guy when he first arrives is just a puppy dog, you know, and that the contrast to what he is at the end is really great. He's really, you did a good job of making it's just like, whoa, it's just really horrific. I love the sound of him that he makes at the end. This is, he's growling. It's just like, I just feel like you could do that for a while. It's just like, what is that sound? Like, there's a lot of, you could play with tensions like this. You've got the basic joke, he's gonna come and he's gonna eat every character. It's like the Punch and Judy formula, you know, someone's gonna get killed in the end of every scene, and this is a similar kind of thing, you know, it's a finger puppet joke. And also I'm thinking maybe that the narrator could have appeared, I think, as a puppet all along, and so when she starts to protest of her situation, and then gets devoured, you know, there's more play with that, I think. It could also help signal the kind of the structure of the piece a little bit better, meaning like how it has a formulaic structure, and I think it gradually emerges to be what it is. This notion of how one puppet can be other puppet is transformation. Puppets do transformation. And even if it's, this is one puppet and here's the other puppet and they're the same puppet. So it's like, it's going to be, it's going to, whatever the switch is going to be, this is what the puppet theater can do. And so you were using video to do the trick in many, many ways. But I think there's like, it would be really fun to take this piece and make it live, right? And which I'm sure is in your brain. And so like how to like, that would be such a delight, because eventually, you know, he seems to get bigger. I can't tell. Is there like three of them and they get bigger and bigger? It's just like, that whole just like, anyway, the nature of evil is laid bare in front of us in a delightful way, a palpable way. So I don't know. How was your experience? Did you have a good time with it?
Oh man, I had a blast. Like this was right up my alley. I have a puppet company over here in the West Coast that we do horror comedy musicals. And okay. Mm-hmm. It was just like, oh yeah, I'm gonna absolutely do that. As soon as I was looking up Connecticut Legends and I saw that one and I was like, oh, a monster, perfect, that's me, okay. and yeah, it was a really, I've not really done a lot of, like heavy editing puppetry video work, so that was an experience for me. And it was a blast to make him. He's terrifying back here.
And it was just a blast. I don't know. My sister was a huge help, and that was really fun as well. So yeah, I had a good time.
Excellent. Good. Yeah. Well, congratulations.
Thank you.
Thank you, Alyssa. Thank you, Blair. For those of you who are just tuning in, we're about to see the 6 of 9 hand puppet videos for the UConn class Hand Puppetry. That was Alyssa Matthews we just saw in the Wacky Galakas. And now we're going to see, and with commentary by Chicago puppeteer Blair Thomas. And now we're going to see The Dinner Party by Anna Yorfino.
Clifford. Get ready for this one. It's a real throwback. I haven't killed anyone since 1984. Go over to this comedian's son's apartment. Come back with something that tells me where that asshole went, so I can wipe this egg off my face. It's a real throwback, isn't it? Oh yes, Clifford, that reminds me. I get to try out my new chicken recipe with Robert De Niro tonight. I have to go grocery shopping. I think I only need chicken breasts. Perfect. I only need to buy those then, I think. This'll be good. Now what is going on in here? Who are you two, and why are you in my kitchen?
I'm Luna, sir. Nice to meet you. This is Greg. He was hungry and thought this nice big nest might have some scraps.
What? This isn't a nest. This is my house. God, I knew I should have closed up that doggy door. Animals like you can't just keep walking through here. This is getting out of hand. Come on, Luna, let's go.
I'm sorry, sir. I didn't mean for us to cause such a big mess.
Ugh, life don't make no sense. It's not fair. I was looking forward to cooking for my house guest tonight, and now I have this to deal with.
Is there anything we can do to help you, sir?
No. Just go, all right? I have to go now.
Well, where are you going, sir?
I'm going to the grocery store. I have to prepare dinner for my dinner guests later. Why am I telling you this?
I have no clue, dude.
Look, just get out of my kitchen, all right? I don't have time for this today.
We leave. I mean, I got what we came here for, right? Did you even see those high-quality cheeses in his fridge? Do you have any sense of morality at all? Where I come from, manners are actually kind of important, you know? And you're totally forgetting about those deli meats.
You come from a tree.
3 minutes from here, and you literally throw up everything you eat. It's called regurgitation, and I don't actually have a choice, you know. That's besides the point anyway. We have to do something, Greg. What are we gonna do, Luna? Mop? Wash the dishes or run the dishwasher? Hmm. That could work, Greg. Good thinking. I should have more faith in you sometimes. You know, Luna, where I come from, we have this thing called sarcasm. Have you heard of it? Where should we start? You know more about this whole kitchens thing than I do. Well, you can start with the mop over there while I take a snack break. Actually, why don't you help me set it up? It's that red stick over there, right? In the bucket? Yes, Luna. That is a mop. Your little bird friends would be so proud to see that their friend Luna has become a housemaid with a fox. What's a housemaid? Wouldn't you like to know? Just give me the mop. You put the dishes in the dishwasher, all right?
It's the metal box over there under the water basin, right? I put those discs in there.
Yes, Luna. You put those dishes in the dishwasher under the sink. Let's get this over with, all right? This is the most ridiculous scavenging trip I've had the pleasure of being on. Recipe turned out splendidly when I tested it at home. Robert should love this, I think. Oh no, the last thing I need is more cowbell. Hello, sir. What can I get for you today? Hello, yes, I would like a couple of chicken breasts, please. Chicken breasts, sir? How many? Six, please. All right, sir, 1 second. Hey, has anyone ever told you that you look just like this famous actor? What? Yes, yes, you look just like someone, I swear. I can't remember their name, though. Christian, no. Cameron? Connor? Gosh, what was it? Yeah, he was in a Pulp Fiction, he was in a Deer Hunter, True Romance. Those are some great movies, sir. Have you seen them? I was in all of those. Christopher! Yeah, you look just like that actor, Christopher Walken. You sound like him, too. I heard he lives around here somewhere. Did you know that, sir? Wilton, Connecticut, of all places. I wonder what he's up to nowadays. Well, he's buying chicken breasts for his dinner party from a butcher that doesn't recognize him. That's a funny joke, sir. You should go into show business sometime. I think you'd be good for it. Can I get a name for the order, sir? Walken. Wow,
And you even share the last name. That's pretty crazy, sir. Let me get your chicken for you. Here you go, sir. Have a nice day. Your total will be $14.77. Would you like a bag for this, sir?
No, thank you.
Forgive me if this is out of place, sir, but you look just like that actor from that SNL sketch. Have you seen it? It's iconic.
God, not again, please.
You should watch it sometime.
I got a fever, and the only prescription is more cowbell.
Legendary, huh?
If you say so, miss. That damn cowbell will ruin me forever. Ugh, come on! I thought I asked you critters to leave! Damn doggy door!
Sir, it's okay, look, we helped!
You don't understand. My dinner guest is due to be here in 2 hours. Can you leave so I can get started cooking my meal, please?
Sir, you don't have to worry as much. You don't have to clean up after us.
I have to clean up after you guys and get myself back in order from the grocery store. Why does nobody know who I am all of a sudden?
Hey, listen! We cleaned your kitchen!
Oh.
See? You really owe us one after I stayed here against my will.
Any more surprises before I open the oven?
Actually, I was thinking we could help you cook. I mean, I usually eat raw meat and don't know how you manage a fire, so I can help you cook something else.
We can give it a try.
Ugh! You owe me a meal after this is over.
Les rêves des amoureux sont comme le bon vin. Ils donnent de la joie ou bien du chagrin. Affaibli par la faim, je suis malheureux. Pas longtemps chemin, tout ce que je peux, car rien n'est gratuit.
Hello? Oh, hi, Robert. We just finished cooking. How soon will you get here?
What?
Are you crazy? You couldn't have told me sooner. You know how much I was looking forward to this. I was gonna test my new recipe on you. Jeez, you're a nut. You're a maniac, a control freak. Fine. I'll talk to you later.
What's wrong, Christopher, sir?
You know what? Enjoy yourselves. You'll find the tossed salad stimulating to your taste buds.
Does it have any beans, Christopher, sir?
Yes.
Greg, it has beans!
Awesome!
Thank you, Anna. For those of you who are just tuning in, that was the sixth of nine hand puppet videos which we're showing tonight, the results of UConn students in hand puppetry. Now I'd like to invite commentary from Blair Thomas.
Anna, thank you for that piece. The final image at the dinner table is masterful. It's just a great ending to that piece, and it's really funny. And like where the piece is going is like, what is this? Okay, there's Christopher Walken. This kind of like, well, you know, this. So, and you've got a pretty good Christopher Walken going on, right? And that it looks like him. You know, the voice is good for the most part, and it's like this great parody of Christopher Walken. And then this, you're like, the animals, they show up to help, and they're like sock puppets, and you're just trying to figure out what's going on, like why are they there, and they have this, there's this weird kind of combination of innocence they have in relationship to this kind of this very jaded and iconic character that we all know, Christopher Walken, and he imagined he's just a guy who lives in Connecticut, and he has to encounter people at the store that's when the piece takes a turn for me at that point, because this is like the scene with him and the butcher is really well written. It's just like the obtuseness of it, the fact that he still never gets it is really, that's really great. And so Christopher Walken is just walking, and he's just walking into all these situations that are intolerable, but not at the same time. Like, why are the, like, he gets home and he gets dumped, and anyway, the piece has it has a way of unraveling into its own nonsensical world in a way that is a world of puppetry. Like, it has that the benign characters of the nothing horrible happened. Like, it's Christopher Walken, you sort of think something horrible is going to happen. Nothing horrible is happening. Instead, there's a very nice meal with a couple of local animals. it's so funny. It's like, that is really funny. That just, that idea is, anyway. Sorry, clearly I enjoyed that idea. But again, you've got some resourcefulness going on. Like, you're at home, you've got some socks, and you've got a way to make these puppets. And I think that you were very inventive with that stuff. And the screens, you know, cutting to the television screen of the our monitor image of the store, also another great use of staying in place, but just like, you know, and all these things very successful. and De Niro's a rat, right? So it all turns out good. What made you want to do the piece on Walken?
My inspiration came from mainly two sources.
Mm-hmm.
One of them is this interview that I watched one time, I think it was on The Daily Show, where Christopher Walken was talking about how he lives in Wilton, Connecticut, where I'm from, and we found that he's actually like about 5 minutes from my house, which is really interesting, but he was talking about how rural his house is in such a rural environment, and
right.
That animals actually do like sneak into his house at times through the doggy door. So that was one bit. And then the second was this video I found with like professional production and stuff, where he's going to Stu Leonard's, which is the grocery store where he goes to in my video, and just cooks a meal because he actually just really likes to cook. So I wanted to mesh those.
Thank you, Blair.
Great.
That was the sixth of nine pieces which we're seeing tonight. And I'd like just to remind people watching on Facebook Live that we are reading your questions and comments as they come in. We'll try to answer questions if possible if there's time, and we'd be very grateful for any comments you have. The next piece we'll be seeing is another puppet video, made for the camera, and it's entitled The Old Leather Man, and it's by Ray Dondero.
Thank you. just keeps rolling. He keeps on rolling along. He don't plant taters. He don't plant cotton. And them that plants it are soon forgotten.
That was The Old Leather Man by Ray Dondereau. Mm-hmm. And the seventh of nine hand puppet videos, which we're watching tonight from University of Connecticut students in hand puppetry. Mm-hmm. Invite some comments and perhaps a response as well. Comments from Chicago puppeteer Blair Thomas.
Thank you for that work, that homage to this enigmatic character that just the little figure that you've created largely through its costume and expressive finger work allows us to enter into the mystery of how a man could live their life like that, how that they could step outside of human interaction and just be constantly in the natural environment. And the way in which you shot it emphasized that particular environment that he would have been experiencing. And so the simplicity of walking on the stones and logs and leaves of a little patch of Connecticut captures that in a wonderful way. And I loved his little hat that he had on his head. It was so simple and subtle, and the color of his costume is also a great combination of browns that make him like a natural beast himself. And again, very nice. The silent movie thing of the super titles giving us some, giving us the context and then the story of the person who remembers them and, you know, is part of their life in that way, even though they're house dwellers. Is a nice kind of grounding thing in relationship to his existence. I appreciated the sections without the music the most, because there was something about like it let more of the environment seep through. The music had a very strong sentiment that came with it. I think that there was an expressivity that gets overpowered by a music sometime, and that could be a taste thing in a couple different ways, but since you're working on such a limited palette with what you're making this portrait with, at some point there's a fairly the sounds of outdoors was as rich as the texture of his costume, and so that was nice. And I appreciate it. Can you tell me a little bit about how you were attracted to this historic character?
Yeah, absolutely. The character himself, I have known about him for only a couple of years, and when I think of Connecticut legend, he's definitely the first person to come to mind. And I think especially because of everything we're going through right now with isolation and such, I felt like this theme and this story about a man who by choice lived in isolation for much of his life was something that could be really powerful. So yeah, it was really fun to do. And thank you so much for all your comments, and especially the ones about the music, because I think the music was something that I struggled with the most and had the most questions about. So it's really good to hear your thoughts on that. Thank you.
Sure. Yeah. Well, thank you. Thank you, Ray.
Thank you, Ray. Thank you, Blair, for this exchange. Coming now to the eighth video of nine videos this evening, hand puppet videos by University of Connecticut students at both the undergraduate as well as the MA, MFA level. And just as a note, some of the students are very experienced puppeteers, while for others, it's their first encounter with any form of puppetry. And so it's been very exciting teaching this course and seeing the different kinds of energies and perspectives brought to bear. The eighth piece is a piece by Anthony Salito, and it's entitled The Three Judges.
Hello, and welcome to England. I'm King Charles I. England is possibly the best place imaginable. I am in a little bit of a fight with Parliament right now. It's because I keep saying they don't exist. Some are calling it a civil war. But F that. I mean, a king can't even be treasonous. If a king was treasonous, he'd just be treasoning himself. They're the ones treasoning me. They're the treasoners. I'm the king, and I'm not treasoning, so I should keep an eye on the treasoners to make sure they're not treasoning. The king shall be killed. You mean executed. What does it matter? Well, we aren't murdering him. We're simply trying him for his crimes against the kingdom. And the result of that is his death. Yes, but it's an important distinction, you see. Oh. It's bloody stupid. What? Oh, nothing, you knob. Did you sign the papers? Yes, of course. And as William?
Of course I have.
What are you doing down there?
I'm just comfortable.
No, he's just scared the king's going to find him. Oh. Yeah, and they don't have enough hands for us up here anyways. All right, well, the king shall die shortly, be executed shortly. Oh, God. I mean, God gave me the divine right to be king. Yeah, no one can betray me. We're betraying you. What? Well, great job. Well done indeed. I'm the new king. You killed my dad. Now I'm gonna kill you. Okay, boys. New lives, new identities, and new voices. America, and most importantly, a huge sea between us and the king. All right, hop on board. William, get on. Edward, help me out with this. The king's closing in.
He's closing in.
That's what I said. Come on, get a move on.
I think you said clothing in.
Oh, I said closing in. Just come on, help me.
Okay, fine. I think the king will still find us when we're overseas.
Oh, how optimistic.
I think you meant to say pessimistic. And anyways, you were being more realistic.
What does it matter?
It's an important distinction. Anyways, like I was saying, the king and the kingdom in general, they're like a vicious, a vicious...
snake?
No. Like a vicious python.
Isn't that a snake?
No, you see, it's an important distinct...
Oh, my God. Hey, wake up. Wake up, I need your help. I need your help, come on. What's that on your mouth?
It's a disguise. You see, the king can't see the noise you have on my face.
The king can't know who you are if you're wearing a turtleneck?
No, it's ordinary. You see,
can you just please help me over here? Come on.
Wait a minute. Are we on a boat?
Yeah, we're escaping the king. Of course we're on a boat.
Oh God. I get seasick.
Can you just pull it together, man?
I'm gonna throw up. Oh God, I'm gonna really seasick.
Oh my God, just come on over here and help me.
Nope.
The men who sentenced the king. Hold on. New England. I want to go home. Well, we can't go back there anymore. To my home? No, to England. My home and England are two very different places with only minor commonalities, okay? It's an important distinction. Oh my God, can you quit it with this distinction rubbish? Distinction garbage. Distinction garbage. Ugh, and we're gonna be found out anyways. You sound English. We need to sound more American. American. American? At least William. At least no one can understand William. Wait. Where is William?
Look what I found!
Some rocks?
No, a cave!
You found a cave! Very good.
No, it's a place to live!
Live in a cave? It's rather nice in here, I do say so myself. Jesus, you're already in there.
Where else would you go?
Okay, I see your point. Go in and get set up. I'm gonna talk to them for a second. This place is effing awful. It's not like England at all, and it's not even new. I mean, look around. There's a bunch of trees and shit. No houses at all. What do you guys do in your free time? Prance around in the woods, foraging and hunting. There's not even a bakery nearby. There's always a bakery. Back in regular England, I'm not calling it old, I could have food at the ready, a cozy home, a cushy job. But this New England garbage is just awful. You've got me at the end of my rope. And worst of all, I'm with them. Did you say so? Get back in the cave. That one just nags and nags all the time and makes distinction after distinction. And the other, he can't even hold himself upright. Oh, I think that I'm gonna go have a lay down.
I think you mean lie down.
Well, John told me to come out here and yell at you briefly. And John came out here and yelled at you briefly, so I think it's my turn. And he also told me to come out here and make some distinctions about when to and when not to speak. I think he was being mean, but... Anywho, you should definitely speak when spoken to. That is, unless you're making a point to not speak, then you shan't. But making a point is different from speaking. You see, you can make a point when speaking, and I think most times people do, but sometimes when people speak, it's pointless. Let me explain. It's pointless because there's something more interesting going on around them. Like, I don't know, something crazy probably. And, oh, one thing that I've been thinking about recently, and also speaking about, is I wish I was back in England instead of drubby old New England. I'm sure you've heard enough from John, but you see, after killing the king and stuff, I would have just rather stayed home.
All right, I heard enough. You killed the king, I knew it. I'm gonna get you. Where are your friends?
They're not in this cave.
They're in that cave then.
No, they're not in the cave.
They're in the cave. Move out of the way.
Can you just let me dust first? I mean, it's really dirty in there. Please, we weren't expecting guests.
Oh my God.
They found us.
Oh, shit. Now where's your third companion?
Where'd you guys go? Is anyone here? Oh, you know, this is all pretty nonsensical, and anything here is crazy right now. And when you think about it, we're all just keeps from families and glued together loosely, just to put out a story and a frustration. Well, really.
All right, and if any of you out there are thinking, oh, didn't the king never catch them? Well, this is my bloody story, okay?
Thank you, Anthony, for that delightful interpretation of three judges, for all of us who grew up in the New Haven area, heard it constantly, but not quite that way. I'd like to invite Blair to say a few words and then to hear a response from Anthony.
Sure, Anthony, thank you for that work. I love that you're living with your form, that the puppet booth is there, the trash bags are playing the role of the curtain, and the Christmas lights have been pulled out early for this season to create the atmosphere. This kind of structure around the work is in many ways, that you set off the context of, like, you are a solo puppeteer and there are three main characters. So it's just like, all right, how is that gonna work? You just like it, and so we're gonna watch you figure that out, and there's a delight in that. The boat hat was brilliant, like, as it sinks in, that's what's going on with that costume set piece. Yeah, great moment. And it may even be worth revealing that you're wearing it at some point, you know, just because of that. I love the logic that you get into in some of the dialogue, the treachery, treason thing at the very beginning. I consider it sort of to be, this is the terrain that puppets are allowed to go into, where nonsense and language can just be united in a way that humans don't have as much of a purview with. And again, it happens with you know, making the point and speaking the point, that whole thing that happens near the end of it. You have another moment with that that is also really great. And so these kinds of things have great energy to them. The relationship of you as the king, and then the successor to the son of the king, with these diminutive hand puppets, is a real treat and a delight. Maybe there could have been some small thing that you put on your face to be the son, so that's so inconsequential to, like, prove, like, that there would be something kind of, because it's happening oh so quick. And which is makes it all the more fun. So the notion that the king is the son of the king is sneaking it up and following them behind, you know, and changing the story is a great twist. It's like just like rewrite the story is a great solution to an otherwise, you know, like tired tale of New England. So I think that having the fun with that is really great. You're exploiting your skills as a showman. And I think that's well used in the energy of this piece. What made you want to do a piece on this one?
So when I first started thinking about the project, I first thought of just this story and the Leather Man story, because those are the two like historical stories that I think of when I think of the place we live in. Mm-hmm. And I leaned more towards the Three Judges just because I had this immediate idea that was like, oh, my head could be the king, and that would be so funny. And it would mm-hmm. be so funny to see little guys and then a big guy.
Yeah, yeah.
I just thought that would be really funny. And I was thinking of like vaudeville-esque weirdness and stuff, and also like a lot of like the Monty Python animations. And
mm-hmm. Yeah.
I sort of just like went from there. Halfway through the process, I was like, this is probably a three-person show.
Yeah.
And I was already too far by then, so I was like, well, it'll be fine, I'm sure.
Yeah, just to realize that things that are that your instinct of like, it would be a delight to see the human king in relationship to the little puppets is right. And the more you can figure out ways in which they interact, the moment when the puppets are strangling you to death is a moment that you could have milked all over that stage, like the like what the puppet is doing, and it's like, you know, how it's pulling down and he's dead but he's back alive, kill him again, or what, you just are, you know, can you throw the head against the table, you know, just like there's so many stupid comic things that have to do with that kind of the Lotsy routine of two puppets and a puppet head, you know. So just to it has to do with like that the relationship, like we like to see this little character interact with the person, like that is the delight, there's synergy between humans and puppets.
Yeah, totally.
Exploit.
I totally should add more of that. Thank you.
yeah.
Thank you, Blair, for those comments, and Anthony for your delightful performance. The final piece of the evening is The Lover's Leap by Elise Vanais.
Yo, this is a sick spot to propose to Amy. There's no way she could say no to me with a view like this. This waterfall is awesome. I freaking love Lover's Leap. It's gonna be the most romantic proposal ever, I swear. You know, I've been wanting to do this since we entered quarantine. We've only gotten into like three fights so far, and we live together, so she's basically the one. I'm gonna get down on one knee just like this and be all like, oh, Amy, will you marry me? And she's gonna be all like, oh my God, yes, Scott, I love you. You're the best lover I've ever had. And then we're gonna make out on this really dangerous ledge here, and it's gonna be awesome. And wait, where is Amy? 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 Oh, geez, Amy, are you okay? No, Scott, I am not okay. I wish you had told me that we were going on a hike today. I wouldn't have worn this maxi dress otherwise. Oh, I'm sorry. I mean, where else did you think we were going? Nothing's open yet. I don't know, you just told me to look nice, so I did. Now I'm covered in dirt, in spider webs, in thorns. Okay, well, I'm sorry next time, okay? Just, here, come look at this view right here.
This ledge doesn't look very safe. Babe, it's fine, trust me, okay? Now look at me. Okay. Amy, babe, you are the smartest, awesomest woman I have ever met. You're super smart, super sexy, super cool, and I am super grateful to have you as my girlfriend. Now, will you do me the honor of being my wife? You're so funny. What? Oh my God. You're being serious? What's wrong with you? What's wrong with me? What's wrong with you? You never take me seriously. Well, how could I? You didn't even get a ring for me. You said our love didn't even need a ring. Oh, God, Scott, it's like you don't even know me. Oh. Oh. I didn't expect that. I guess that's our fourth fight in quarantine. You should kill yourself. What? Weird, okay. I just really thought she'd be happy and seriously jump off. Oh, where's that coming from? Anyways, maybe I should have just gotten her and seriously kill yourself. Okay, who said that? That would be me. Hi, I'm Lilinana, the tragic spirit of Lover's Leap. So wonderful to meet you. Who are you? Why are you telling me to jump off the ledge? Oh wow, you haven't heard of me? Weird, but okay. Well, you know how this park is called Lover's Leap? You know why, right? No? Wow, okay, guess I've got to educate you then. History lesson. That's okay, you're cute enough to make up for it. So, anyways, back when I was alive, roaming the forest, this land used to belong to my people, the Wantanak. We would gather right here, and on special occasions, we would celebrate our way of life. The forest not only provided us with beauty, but with resources such as food and shelter. This river, the one I lost my very life in, was bountiful with fish in which we caught and feasted on. One day, while I was walking through the forest, I found a very ill man. He was handsome and kind and wise. I nursed him back to health and we quickly fell in love. Oh, that's beautiful. Oh, I know it is. But then he told me he had to return to his family. He promised he would return for me, however long it would take. So I waited 9 months. I watched as the leaves bloomed and then turned the colors of fire and then fell to the ground. By then, my father, the chief of the Wantanak, decided I must marry someone else. I could not do it as I had promised to wait for my one true love. So I cast myself off this very ledge out of utter heartbreak. Holy shit, that's intense.
Oh, I know, right? Oh, you get it. But then anyways, my true love came back right when I jumped. He was so heartbroken that he followed me in. It's honestly an even better love story than Romeo and Juliet, if you ask me. So, we went down in Connecticut's history, and then the park was named after us. They couldn't be bothered to acknowledge that the land was once where my people lived, though. Rude.
That's crazy.
Thank you for saying that. You're so adorable.
So, why are you here?
Oh, I haunt the place now, obviously. My lover moved on, and I've been alone for years.
Okay, so why were you telling me to jump then?
You're still not getting it. Okay, that's okay. Did you really think I'd just idly sit by and watch people hike? No way. The legend is that now, if you propose to someone on this very spot, as you just did, and you get rejected, as you just did, I either convince you to jump off the ledge or I push you. Sorry, I don't make the rules.
What? You have to push me?
Yeah, but But don't worry. We can make Amy totally jealous. She'll feel terrible, and then you'll get to be with me forever. We'll make such a cute couple. And it's super fun being a ghost, I promise. It doesn't hurt to die at all. What? No way. I don't want to die. Oh, come on. Jump. No. Okay. You're gonna make me do it the hard way then. Oh, no. Ugh. Ah. Oh, okay. I guess this is gonna take some planning. Oh, I know. Ooh. Scott? Hello? Look, I'm sorry, okay? I was just in a bad mood. I do want to be your wife. I don't need a ring. I think I picked a fight because, well, I'm scared for our future. Not because I don't think we won't make it. It's just the world is uncertain and scary right now. I don't even know if we'll be able to afford a wedding. But I do know that I love you, and I do want to be your wife. Wait, Scott, where are you? Ooh. Oh, are you a ghost? That's me, a ghost and Scott's new girlfriend. What? Yeah, after you acted like a total bitch and heartlessly rejected Scott, he jumped off the edge. Don't worry, it's a painless death, I should know. Anyways, you're a horrible person. You should just go now. What? Oh my God, Scott! Oh, there's no way Scott would do that unless... You pushed him. I know you. You're the ghost that haunts this park. You push heartbroken people off the ledge. Okay, good. So you have heard of me. I was worried. You killed him. Guilty. Ugh. Oh, you shouldn't have done that. Well, that takes care of that. Now where'd Scott go? Ooh. Amy? Amy, I heard you scream. Are you all right? Where are you? Oh, Scott, it was the most terrible thing. You see, she came back looking for you and she got too close to the ledge and she slipped. Oh my God, Amy, I don't see her. Where is she? That's right, get a little bit closer. Maybe you can see her there. I don't see her, I still don't see her. Well, that was easy. Now I just wait for their ghosts to return. Uh-oh. I hope Amy shares. Oh, well.
Thank you, Elise. That was Elise Finesse in the Lover's Leap. I'd like to invite some comments from Blair Thomas.
Yes, Elise, thank you. Thank you for that piece with the of the Lover's Leap and you know, a much more traditional show. I can imagine playing out in a booth, you know, and we have the ghost who dispenses with the bodies and
that's the way to do it.
tossing them overboard and is really carrying the spirit of Punch with the destruction of another puppet. And I loved it when the ghost is grabbing her by the hair, pulling her around. It really captures that energy that's really exciting, and a wonderful twist you've made with the narrative, like, are just coming up with a version of the narrative that plays out in a cruel gallows humor, and which was very nice. And the puppets had a real nice design to them. I thought, you know, they both kind of fit their characters really well. The groom wannabe young man was really wonderfully clean cut, and then his girlfriend was I love the way that she was dressed in this absurd kind of petticoat thing that she's got going on. The opening sequence is really nice, his little monologue where he's talking about going down on his knee and he's imagining her response. Was a great opening of hand puppetry in terms of coming up with dialogue and how puppets can speak in that way. So a lot of good twists and turns with the narrative add surprises to your story. Can you tell us a little bit about why this captured your imagination?
Yeah, absolutely. I really love stories that have themes of heartbreak and like the ghostly supernatural things. So naturally, when I came across this story, which there's actually like a lot of stories very similar to this in New England. Like if you talk to anybody, they're like, oh, I've heard a story like that, except it's at like this local park. Actually in my hometown, there's like a story that's extremely similar to it. So I just kind of wanted to do something along the lines of like jealousy, and I like ghosts, so I wanted to have a ghost in it. And I just kind of wanted to make people laugh. Like I wanted to do something kind of cheesy, not too serious. I wanted to challenge myself with doing a traditional hand show because the Punch and Judy unit of our class was my favorite. So I kind of wanted to see if I could like, you know, create my own traditional hand puppets like that. So that was like a big part of why I wanted to do this kind of show, but that's pretty much it.
Yeah, it's like the Punch and Judy show is like a formula that somehow works, you know, and the solo puppeteer executing it, you know, that you've got to get one puppet off stage before the other puppet can come back on. And, you know, this the coming up with like, how do you make the logic of that work? And I think you propelled the narrative forward under those conditions in a great way. So congratulations on that.
Thank you very much, Elise, and thank you so much, Blair Thomas. It's been a tremendous honor to have you with our students these long 2 evenings, which you've been with for our finals, in the midst of your own crits at the Institute in Chicago.
Yeah, no, it's been on a roll. It's good. Who's got some more work? Let's go.
But it's been a great learning experience for all of us, I think, to be able to sit with you and to have this opportunity in the virtual space.
Yeah.
To see your insights off the cuff as they are, but informed by your great knowledge and expertise in the field.
Well, thank you. It was such an honor. Like this was like one of the big boons for me of this staying at home and place situation. I was like that all of a sudden I got this opportunity to be with you guys on crits. This is like, oh my God, that's like, that would be, I'm getting a car and drive out for this. This is awesome. You know, and it's just happening. It's just like, that would never have crossed your minds before. And I'm like, so.
Yes,
unexpected benefits.
I add my thanks for your presence, Blair. It's been really terrific, and I congratulate all the students. Your work is really remarkable. The creativity that you're showing in this challenging time is really inspiring. I also want to thank again Emily Wicks, Paul Spirito, and Tracy Becker for serving as our technicians for both of these evenings with an event that has run so smoothly, I can't believe it. And for our audience members, thank you for joining us. We really appreciate it. We hope to see you again online. And as I mentioned earlier on, I would suggest taking a look at the Ballard Institute Museum of Puppetry website, bimp.ucon.edu, for many, many events that are being hosted by John Bell and Emily Wicks and the puppet art students. There's a lot to be offered. I believe the next event is actually going to be on Monday evening, where a puppet arts alumni, Sarah Frechette, is going to be talking about her work with Albrecht Roser. and I'll be joining her with that because Albrecht is also my mentor. So for the audience, we ask you to please stay safe, stay healthy, and we hope to see you again soon. For the puppet art students and faculty, if you can stay on the Zoom window, we'll have a wrap up, okay? Bye to our audience. Thank you.
Bye.